beautiful tan oak forest, tan oak and redwood. And what do we have here? Quickly and move on because this feels
all eight now, and we're on our way back.
All right, what I brought home, I'm here to show you how to cook, is the coral mushroom. And what I have here is the ramaria areospora. It's a red coral mushroom, and I just like to call it the red coral, or pink. And it was picked yesterday. Now you can see why. This is not a species that you would find in the store, because within a day, it doesn't take very long, it starts to dry out, and I'm getting the little tiny tips just drying out. So that is definitely something to think about when foraging. You only want to pick how much you can prepare. And this little box, kind of recyclable fruit basket, is perfect for bringing along a mushroom hunt, because you know exactly the size you're bringing back. And in the forest, things look smaller or bigger, and the size, you end up with 5 pounds of mushrooms very easily sometimes in a good season. So let's get to cooking these beautiful specimens. Now, I have personally tried the ramaria formosa, or this yellow type. It was much brighter yesterday. And so I know that I'm not sensitive to it. It does not cause gastric upset with me. I feel fine after eating it, and it does taste like just basically any store-bought mushroom, except the texture is amazing. It has kind of the texture of long fibrils type of, just like chicken, basically. And you can use the same seasonings and pretty much cook it in the same way. You can see that it starts off really delicate. When it's fresh, it'll crack and it's brittle, it'll break apart. But once you cook it, it will pretty much stay together. So
the first thing we're going to do is start off with a clean surface and a sharp knife. Kitchen tools are essential. You'll clean your pieces by going over it. You can use a can of air to blow little pieces out from the inside. But as you can see, there will still be a couple of pieces in the mix that you can't really reach. So instead of just breaking it apart, you go ahead and slice lengthwise. So you start with a good side that's almost already flat, and it opens it up so it's easier to clean out. Now you can run it under water or just pick out the parts. Now right now, you're about to cook the mushroom. You wouldn't be slicing it to store it. So after slicing it, running it under water is not going to damage the texture of the mushroom, unless you're soaking it in water. And you shouldn't do that. So, you just take out any kind of bits and inspect each slice. Set the slices off to the side. Keep going. And this is the Formosa, and you'll see that the branching is slightly different from the Areospora. And here's another thing that I'll do to clean the mushroom. I will take the outer layer of the base off. And you can use a knife, or you could use a potato peeler. I'm sure I have a thing here. Just peel the base. You don't want to lose too much of the mushroom, because as you can see, these mushrooms aren't as big as they could get, but this might be the most delicious form to eat them in, as they're super young, and you just want to have a variety of kitchen tools available. Now this is the kind of size of a knife that you would bring on a foray, and you might do this out there once and then come back home and give it a little peeling again and get it really, really clean that way at the base. This is great to add to the compost in the yard. So now we're going to do the same thing, canned air or blow on it, and give it a small slice, inspect the slice for pieces, and set it aside. And it's a process that allows you to clean while going forward with the process of preparing the meal. Look at how beautiful it is, how symmetrical it is. This really didn't have all that much in it as far as dirt or anything, but it is absolutely beautiful. Each one is like its own little mandala. So beautiful. And that is how to prepare it for cooking. Now let's get to our recipe. Now I decided I'm going to do a mushroom dish. This is going to help you understand how to incorporate the wild mushrooms into your foods. I'm crushing this garlic this is one of the first things you want to do before you start cooking. And this just allows the flavor to blossom. I'm just going to set it aside and allow that flavor to blossom. Boiling water, 3 cups of boiling water and 1 cup of pasta.
Now that you've added the pasta, season it well with salt.
Good idea. Leave the cover off. The next thing is get a frying pan all clean and everything. Mine has some stains, but put it on high. Get that going. Get it hot. I'm just drying it off. And then put it onto a medium temperature. Let it just sit at medium for a while. And I really want garlic. So now's the time to sprinkle some salt in there. About that much salt. I'm going generous on the oil because I'm going to try to tip the pan on there, remove it. Some of this could go right onto the garlic for now. I'm just infusing that. And so we've got our beautiful, now I wish the light would be better, maybe if I hold it in front of the window, beautiful pink, rosy, beautiful. Oops, there in the window pasta. Maybe if I turn off my light, it's a little dark. So it is on medium and it's cooking up really fast. I'm going to turn it down to and this pasta, don't you think it's perfect? It's a little, I allowed it to sit for a little extra time. So it's the 5 minutes on, 5 minutes off, or 3 minutes on, 3 minutes off for a sense. So we go through and flip. Now, two factors affect have something brown on the outside. It's the heat and the saturation of heat. It's not a good thing. All right, we're trying to find a happy medium here. And save the olive oil for the pasta and just toss some around. Time to get these off the plate. And they can go anywhere and they're really easy. I'm just going to try to pick up the least amount of oil. And they also would like a little puffy on the inside, a little bowed out. It's a perfect I like wooden cutting boards for vegetables because when you do this, it's going to absorb the extra oil. We still have more. We're going to watch these a little more closely. I like these closer to underdone. For some reason, that's how I've been eating them. That's how I've been getting sick. So let's just put this together so you can see what I'm talking about. We are on simmer, so it's cooking quite fast. The amount of time is the saturation of heat. And so time and heat are the two factors I was talking about. It seems like these just got, my time just got saturated with heat. And even on the simmer, it is cooking fast. See how fast that is? That's like less than a minute. So, I'm not very happy with them cooking very fast. And, maybe not very happy cooking, but I did preheat them. So, it allowed it to get as hot as a pan could get. It's really well cooked. So it might be a good time to use the spatula or something to really just kind of lock in the flavor and press it into the pan. And it's only been 2 minutes, but these are completely golden brown on all edges. Sizzle there for a while and I'll scoop them out and put them on the cutting board. You can see the remaining oil is still very clear. I didn't really pick up the ramaria mushroom, the coral mushroom. But with this extra oil from the mushroom cooking, I'm actually going to just discard this because it is kind of unknown. And no, I don't get sick from it. I just don't want to overdo when I have oil specifically. So rather than sink this and risk spoilage, that's fine. Toss it.
No, I couldn't toss it. It smells so sweet. Anyway. I do not see how this is similar. All right, try to simmer your pasta sauce. Just choose an organic marinara. We'll make it a garlic marinara, no problem. You don't need more preservatives. You need a fresh taste of this blossom flavor of garlic. Put it all in there.
I just gotta make sure I use every utensil in the kitchen sometimes. I mean, sometimes I feel like my subconscious just has that mission. The rubber spatula always comes out. But don't you see how it just gets everything out of there? It's everything else for. That's what we went through all the trouble for. Every little bit of milk. Yeah. So that way I can do it. Oh, put it in there. Good. And basically, you're getting the idea. You can cook anything you want and put those cooked fried mushrooms on top. Once they're pan fried and cooked all the way through, give it one bite and wait 20 minutes. And then eat a small portion. And after identifying them as an edible species, you know that you're not eating a poison mushroom. That's the first step. And then when it comes to eating it, this is the second step, the 20 minute. Your first taste is going to tell you if you have some kind of, perhaps it's genetic or spiritual or who knows. If you have something that is not going to accept that in your body, you're the kind of person who's going to get sick or feel nauseous from eating the yellow type, you're going to know in the first 3 hours. So you could sit down and have about a tablespoon's worth. About a couple slices, but they have such a good texture. It's worth trying, even compared to the same batch cooked as the pink variety. This is more meaty. More like a cauliflower because it's younger, and this one is more tender all the way through to the stalk. It's very nice texture. So if you're not the kind of person who gets sick from it, it's actually delicious. And by delicious, I mean if you know how to cook it or if you have a great recipe to top. Now, mushrooms go for their protein. We eat them for their protein, microproteins. We also eat mushrooms for their medicinal effects, like the reishi mushroom, and the cordyceps mushroom, and the chaga mushroom, and so many other mushrooms that are used medicinally around the world. It's very interesting. So no wonder why there's such mushrooms that look so similar, that are so different, that affect people so differently. Almost everyone can eat the pink variety, but very few can eat the yellow or other colors, especially the white. And they're best left in the forest as a decoration. Think of them as the fairy's grand sculpt of art in the forest. You don't want to run up and pick something that you're not going to use. So I left a bunch behind. I love it. So I grabbed the really good parts, and then I repaired the area so it doesn't look like a big hole through there. Okay. Now I believe the sauce is ready. This is when I mix it in with the pasta. I'm pre-mixing. It gets a chance to merge flavors and makes the grain part of the meal less prominent. This is a great sauce. And all that's needed now is is to serve it, and then lay the strips of the mushrooms across the top. Ta-da! And sprinkle a little salt on it.
Isn't that beautiful?
Well, there you go, from forest to kitchen. Foraged wild corals. How to go about tasting them, eating them safely, finding out if you're allergic to them. And we do have somamushrooms.org, and there's a poison identification number there. If you have any questions, I always take those before eating and get a definite identification before trying any wild mushroom, but this is your coral for you. These are two of the types of corals, and they're known to be edible. Enjoy.
Okay, so this is a good spot to have a little bite outside on the porch. I'm going to try that Formosa. Honestly, it tastes like pizza dough. Cooked, you know, like pizza crust. It tastes like cheese seasoned pizza crust. It's such a weird, with the texture of chicken breast. That garlic pasta. And I hope you enjoy trying this with your coral mushroom. I hope you have a really good pasta sauce. There's always room for more sauce, huh? Oh my gosh. There's green olives in there. And here's the pink coral mushroom. Not the same delicious flavor as the yellow. More of a flavor of the stringy, like a calamari. It's tougher because it's younger, so maybe if it was a little older, it would have been more tender. So from now on, I'm just gonna leave it and not pick it. Unless it's like 4 inches tall or more. Because I don't want to get something that tough. Man. Let's go forage for some mushrooms.